part of Ghent University Metal Science and Technology Group. And today I will speak about evaluation of butterfly wings formation in bearing steel, the role of non-metallic inclusions, and hydrogen. I would just like to mention that I am funding is done by SIMS, which stands for Strategic Initiative of Materials. And this is part of a project, is part of Umbrella. So Maduro stands for Material Durability Offshore. I will briefly introduce premature bearing failures, followed by the hydrogen in bearing steels, and finish with the results and conclusions. So the premature bearing failures are the main reason why there is a high downtime of the gearboxes for the offshore wind turbines, which really increase the cost for operation and maintenance. So as you can see, the gearboxes, the high-speed bearing are failing, and the design lifetime is 20 years, but they fail within 5 years of time. So this is how they look like when they are out of service. I will now show you how this is followed on a microstructural level. So they usually start on the defects in material like non-metallic inclusions. Then they tend to propagate and form the correct networks. And once they reach the surface of the bearing, they cause the failure. I will, on the next slide, focus on this butterfly wing formation. So as we have the contact of the roller and the inner bearing, the subsurface stresses are highest, somewhere up to 1 millimeter, of course, depending on the contact pressure in the bearing. And if you have then there non-metallic inclusion, this will result from the initial bulk material, which is martensitic matrix, so very hard and brittle material, will form those cracks, usually in the 45 degrees orientation. Then this microstructure will be nanocrystalline ferrite. I would like also to show some of my previous work, which is done on ACOM-TM. So we have this altered region. We are looking at the Fib slice. So this is a very small sample. And we can see that the bottom part of the image is corresponding to martensitic matrix, so bulk material. And then the upper part, those small, very small grains, are corresponding to the altered region. Why do we call it white etching cracks? Because they are so small that they resist to etching. So we just see it as a white under light optical microscopy. And what it's important to mention here is that the interface between those two is really sharp, that the grains are, most of them are below the 30 nanometers in this zone, and they're spherical. So this suggests that initial microstructure from martensitic transform through to severe plastic deformation, followed by recrystallization into very small grains. Now when we know more about this mechanism in the bearings, I would like to present a hydrogen, why the hydrogen actually is important here. Because hydrogen ingress in the bearings can be in the application as the composition of the lubricant, electrical current, or just the process of steel making. So in the literature is stated that the hydrogen would actually accumulate at the boundary between bulk material and inclusion, which would result in the decrease of the cohesive strength, and therefore the crack would initiate earlier. So now when we know more about the bearings and the hydrogen, I would like to follow with the results. What was done in this study is that the laboratory cast two materials, which are very similar to the bearing steel 5200, so very high carbon content, and chromium content. What is different is that in the first one, we kept the sulfur content very low, lowest possible, to result in lower amount of non-metallic inclusions. And in the second one, we tried to keep it as close as possible to the standard. The heat treatment was low temperature tapering, so everything was done according to the standard for the bearing steel. And you can see that, that the microstructure is martensite with some chromium carbides. And then we would like to study the influence of steel cleanliness and the hydrogen on the mechanical properties. How did we introduce hydrogen in our material? By electrochemical charging. Electrolyte was sulfuric acid and urea. By adding to urea, we were sure that there were no any gas around the sample. Then that sample is really fully charged with hydrogen. And then the current density was 1 milliampere per square centimeter. Before we do any hydrogen test, we have to know what would be the time for the sample to be fully saturated with hydrogen. And this was done by the malt extraction test. So we heated the sample to 1550 degrees, and then we measured the flow of hydrogen gas by thermal conductivity detector. And you can see that we also measure the samples without any hydrogen to be sure that during production of these samples, we didn't introduce any hydrogen. And then this was done for different times up to 8 hours. And we can see for both materials, it's something around 2 hours, we reached the saturation level. Then we did bending test. I guess that all of you wonder how this rolling contact fatigue has to do anything with the bending test. So the first motivation to do this is that most of my work is based on the bearings which are failed from the field. So it's very hard to track damage evolution when everything is already fall apart. And then the second motivation is that if you do the rolling contact fatigue test, even in the laboratory test rig, it takes few weeks for the test to be conducted. Therefore, and we don't have in situ charging. And if we charge with the hydrogen prior, we can always argue, was there any hydrogen during all these weeks that the test was performed? Therefore, we realized, okay, let's just start with something which is more in the controlled parameters in the lab that we can see how the hydrogen influences our material, and then we will follow more of the application, how we can really get closer what's happening in the bearings during the application. So the test which was done is 3-point bending test. We did two conditions, so one in the air without presence of hydrogen to see what's the fracture surface, and then with hydrogen in situ. So we firstly charge for 2 hours, then we are sure that the sample is fully charged with hydrogen, and then we continuously did a bending test, and then the formation was 1 millimeter per minute. I think you already know this setup from yesterday from my colleague Marho, but if you would like to know more about it, I would refer to her paper or to herself because she's present at the conference. Now if you look at the fracture surface of the sample which was polluted and without any hydrogen present, we can see that the weakest link in this material would be the carbides. Don't be misled by this dimple-looking fracture, because material is very hard and brittle. We don't have any plasticity. We don't expect any dimples to be present in material. And then once we introduce hydrogen, we can see that there is intergranular type of fracture and very nice facets over here. So we still have those carbides, which are very important in the fracture mechanism. But we also introduced the intergranular, which means that the hydrogen is weakening the prior austenitic grain boundaries. I would also like to mention that the embrittlement index for the both material was similar. We now pay attention on the tension side of the ND plane of the sample. We can see that for the test which is done without hydrogen, that there are a lot of cracks which are present parallel to the fracture surface. And then once we introduce hydrogen, beside those cracks which are present also in the reference test, we also have a lot of cracking which are perpendicular to the fracture surface. This is a closer look to it. I would think that the most logical is, as I said, the presence of hydrogen would weaken those grain boundaries, and if this is the weakest link, that's where the crack goes. If we pay more attention to this ND side of the reference sample, which I'm showing here now, I could observe something really interesting. As you can see, there are a lot of non-metallic inclusions and the cracks which are initiating around it. That really appears like the butterfly wing. Of course, because we applied different tests, we don't have a rolling contact fatigue, and we don't have the surface rubbing, which would actually end up in the severe plastic deformation and the altered area. We don't have this altered area, but we have very similar to the butterfly wing in the bearing steel formation. Why do we have it also in reference level test and with hydrogen? I wouldn't dare to say that hydrogen doesn't play a role. I think with the current parameters that we conducted, we cannot see this acceleration of the rolling that would happen in rolling contact fatigue. So I think we need to do more tests, maybe interrupted, so we actually see what how the hydrogen accelerate this crack initiation. This was seen also for the both clean and polluted material. Consequently, in the clean material, we have less non-metallic inclusions, so there were less butterfly wing cracks. I would just like to show how this looks like on the EBSD scan, how the crack forms around non-metallic inclusions. And with this, I would like to come to conclusions that the hydrogen weakens the pyrolysis grain boundaries, which actually resulted in a different fracture behavior for the samples which are hydrogen precharged. And as this all leads to the header mechanism, then if we have a hydrogen sample, there is more cracking observed. That the same trend follow for the clean and polluted steel. And we could actually observe something which is very similar to the butterfly wings in the bearings. And I would rather say that this is stress related, and especially in the bearings through the as I said, rolling contact fatigue and the subsurface stresses, which are highest subsurface. And then this is probably the reason why this damage initiate in material. Thank you.
Thank you for the nice presentation. We are open to questions. Please, one.